So this is a pretty exciting video. So I've been waiting for this to happen for a while now. So just to give you some context, so GPT-4o got introduced like 5 months, 6 months ago, and it was able to do
Assistant
this.
Internet. And if you see, there's this little icon on the bottom right of the ChatGPT app, and this will open up GPT-4o's audio capabilities. Hey, ChatGPT, I'm Mark. How are you?
Oh, Mark. I'm doing great. Thanks for asking. How about you?
Hey, so.
So when this came out, it just blew people's minds, and it was like, oh my God, it's a actual agent that you're able to interact with. And people were like, what on earth is going on? Now, I actually have access to these same APIs programmatically, and like I can start a session and hey, ChatGPT, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks for asking. How about you?
So I'm showing a demo today of the real-time API, and you're going to be on stage.
That sounds exciting. I'm ready to help you dazzle everyone with a slick demo. What do you need from me to get prepped for the big show?
So I'm just going to stop this. But yeah, you get the point. So the context here is that we've been trying to do this a lot before, and this is an AI assistant demo that we built using again, we used a lot of LLMs, and this is also on the YouTube website here. Like, I'll put a link down in the description below. But it was able to
I mean, I've been feeling tired. I thought it was maybe exercise related. I stopped exercising, and I just don't have the energy. It's
So it intercepts the call between two people. It listens to what they are saying, and then it immediately like sends it to an LLM, suggests potential diagnosis, questions, and so on, right? But the way that this typically worked was that, let me open this up real quick. So you have the voice, right? So we had to translate this voice into text first. And again, this was done through again through OpenAI's models, but then this was always the bottleneck, right? So there was voice and there is text here. So you have like a model like Whisper doing all of the translation, and then you would take this text, and then you would do some prompt engineering, and this is then prompt engineering plus LLM, and then you'd get your final results here, right? So this what we had before, as soon as I saw the GPT-4o demo, I was like, all of this is gonna go out of the it's gonna blow this whole thing out of the water. This whole real-time API where you're able to pass in voice real-time to a model, and then you're just able to get back response immediately. And I wasn't wrong, right? Like, I tried playing around this quite a bit, and we've been attempting to. So we have an EHR, so this is ophthalmology specific forms here, and we've been trying to get this to work so that this is primarily for my father, who is an ophthalmologist. He has his own eye hospital, and he does not ever type. Like, he does not ever even like look at the screen, or like he's really slow at typing. So he has a nurse who listens to what he has to say, and then they actually do the typing, right? So for the longest time, he's kind of been using this nurse as an agent who just listens to what he says, and then like they do the typing. But a lot of doctors, like, they don't really have that level of sophistication, and they can't really like hire a person just to type or like take notes, so they do it themselves. But this got me thinking, like, we've been working on this for a while. We've been trying this style approach where you translate the incoming voice to text first, and then you take the text, and then you're able to do some function calling using OpenAI or some of the other LLMs, and then you're able to bind that back to a form, right? But then what I realized in the real-time playground was this supports function calling natively. Like, you can add a function here, you can talk directly to the agent, and then it'll call this function immediately, right? And this blew my mind, because like the speed at which it's able to do this function calls is insane, right? Like, let me show you. So this is, again, a model of this particular form for ophthalmology where they talk about the findings of the eye. I have a sample here. I have a demo where the real-time API is being used. And trust me when I say, like, it's never been this good ever. Like, we've tried it with all different sorts of models before. And, you know, with RAG, with, like, retrieving different vectors. And we've done a bunch of stuff, right? But then the limiting factor was always this voice to text. Because with Whisper, there is only some prompting you can do. You can prompt Whisper. Like, many people don't know you can prompt Whisper. But there is only a certain level of prompting you can do. And so what happens is that, for example, here I have a test sentence for you, right? Like, for example, something like, this is actually transcribed by Whisper. It's saying copious nodule in the right iris, but it's actually copious nodule. So that's a very specific medical term. And without context that this is being done for ophthalmology, the model has no chance of getting this right. So what you had to do before was you had to convert the voice into the correct text and then also prompt the LLM here that, hey, this text might actually be slightly inaccurate. So you may want to correct things and then, like, change the actual data before you get the results, right? But what's happening right now is we don't have any of these steps anymore. There's no Whisper. It's just a single LLM that's making a call directly. So you just have prompt engineering plus LLM and you get the results directly. So I just want to show you what this looks like, right? Like, so this is a form and this is like a very small demo. And again, I am I want to make sure that it's able to also identify SNOMED CT terms and like a bit of the code systems if it shows up. So if it finds something that's related to, so for example, non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy due to diabetes mellitus, this is a disorder, and it will show this particular disorder in this exact same style. But you can imagine how this can be used to bind it to a particular code, for example. And again, this is my prompt. I'm going to show you exactly what I'm doing and what is going on. You're a helpful assistant for an ophthalmologist. Your task is to correct errors or mistakes in transcription and output the most appropriate data using set clinical signs function. Use the concepts that are in the vocabulary if possible. Use the following vocabulary. I think this is not really needed because, like, it listens to the audio directly now. And I'm going to start. And there is a mode in the real-time API where you can just ask it to, like, output function calls and not talk back, right? So let's begin with the demo. I am going to try and read this out, but then I'm going to stop now and then and just show you how natural this feels. It almost feels like talking to a real person, right? Right cornea dendritic ulcer. Left cornea central corneal ulcer. Now, it's got all of this. I'm continuing to talk, and it's not, you know, it's not recording anything that I'm saying because it knows that it's irrelevant. But then I can just say, like, hey, can you switch this around? Can you make the left cornea dendritic ulcer and the other way around? There we go. And not only is this exactly right, but it's also... It's also using the right SNOMED CT terms. Now, again, in the prompting, I'm gonna stop this. In the prompting, I have told it, like, do not talk back, only call the function to update the state of the clinical signs. And, you know, I've said all this and the modality is only text, but it still talks back. Like, so there is still some level of, it just doesn't know that it shouldn't talk back. And, like, I've tried to say, like, no, don't talk back, but it's like sometimes it just I think you might have heard that quickly. And there are two types of turn detection here. One is the server VAD, the other one is we just disable this completely, and then that way you need to record, you need to start recording and then, like, stop, and then it will process that, right? So that's usually, like, useful if the practitioner can, for example, have a switch on their on their table, or maybe like a foot pedal or something, and then they know exactly when they are talking to the model and when they are like doing other things, and they can just like, this is basically push to talk, right? So the push to talk also is fine. Like, so for example here, let me try something. Right lens has developmental cataract, left lens has senile cataract. And once I stop talking, then it records this thing. And again, like, I did not tell it that this is, I've never seen this level of accuracy ever before, right? So if the advantage here, again, like as I told you before, is that since the prompt engineering can apply directly to the voice, and you have such a huge context length to fit in all of these different clinical terms, you can actually quite easily load this up with all of the relevant clinical terms that are relevant for this particular form here, right? And then as they are talking, you are able to just bring out the more relevant terms and then like fit it into the context, and it will almost get it right almost all the time. And then even if it makes a mistake, it understands the context. So it still is in the same session. So I can say things like, can you just change the developmental cataract to senile cataract as well? And it understands, it changes that to senile cataract, right? So to me, like, seeing this was crazy, right? Like, I was blown away by how fast and instant it's able to perform. And like, this basically beats out, like, if you're working on one of these whisper, like, text-based interfaces where you convert the voice to text first and then use the text for the LLM, like, stop. Like, this is gonna outperform almost anything that you're gonna do where you're gonna go to text in the middle, right? And this is just so much faster. Like, I can literally talk and, you know, like, for example, let's say left eye has acute dacrocystitis going for lacrimal abscess. So left eye, ocular adnex. I didn't even say that it's ocular adnex. It just knows, right? Like, it has enough clinical context to know that this exact finding is supposed to be put here on the left side. And this is a relatively complex form, right? Like, let me try something else with, you know, like, okay, let's try NPDR, right? Like, so NPDR is a short form for non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy due to diabetes mellitus. I want to see if NPDR, if I say NPDR on left eye, it should identify that it's under retina and also use this particular code. So let's try that. NPDR on left eye. Okay, it got NPDR, but let's say, can you expand on that? Non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy due to diabetes mellitus. This is exactly the, you know, the SNOMED CT terminology that we would use. And again, like, it makes mistakes. I'm not saying that it doesn't, but then it's so good now at understanding the context that it is so easy to correct these mistakes immediately. So even if I say senile cataract and it like records it as text and there is actually a coding for it here, you could literally say like, hey, can you use the coding? And it understands that and it like immediately makes the change. So I don't know what you think. Like, let me know in the comments below. Is this something that changes the way that you build? How are you going to use the new real-time APIs? And again, this is just like scratching the surface because this is a very specific use case, right? So the practitioner is talking and then you do function calls to bind back to forms based on certain, you know, the clinical findings and so on. But like, it can also talk back, right? Like, so how are you going to use the real-time APIs? Are you going to use it for better patient engagement, maybe? Like, you can actually make phone calls to a patient and ask them, like, hey, how are you doing? And ask them for a certain number of screening questions on the phone automatically. And these are, like, agents that are there running 24/7. So I'm excited. But although, like, a fair bit of warning right now, which the voice generation is extremely expensive. So it may not be feasible. It may sometimes be easier to just hire a person for the same rates. But then I think it's going to get 10 times cheaper in another year or so. Right. So, like, I think Moore's law applies to everything in AI probably faster than anything else. Like, if you see GPT-3 or like GPT-4, even like when it came out, it was like, oh, this is this big model. Now you have like GPT-4 Turbo and so on. It's super fast. It's able to, it's super cheap. You can just use it. And like, you even have like the smaller mini versions of it coming out. So, yeah, I don't know. I think you should definitely look at it in the context of the next 4 to 5 years, where all of this will get cheaper. We are maybe going to get open source models and open models that can do similarly. And I'm pretty sure Llama and Facebook is not just going to sit behind and wait for OpenAI to just like do voice capabilities while they don't do anything. That definitely, like, people are going to catch up. So yeah, I mean, I'm really excited. I want to tell me what you think down in the comments below. And thanks for watching.